Hello everyone, welcome to the session on the elasticity and absorption approach to balance of payment and devaluation. We have already seen that devaluation refers to a deliberate reduction in the external value of domestic currency or an increase in the nominal exchange rate. Devaluation is adopted when a country faces persistent deficit in its current account and subsequent disequilibrium in balance of payment. The elasticity approach analyzes what happens to the current account when a country devalues its currency, while the absorption approach traces out the income effect of devaluation. We will begin with the elasticity approach and will derive the celebrated Marshall-Lerner condition and two related concepts of it, namely the J-curve and currency pass-through. Welcome to the video. Thus, elasticity approach analyzes what happens to the current account of a country when it devalues its currency. The approach was pioneered by Alfred Marshall and Lerner, but later it was extended by John Robinson and MacLeod. Since the model is based upon the trade flows and the speed of adjustment depends upon how elastic and how responsive the imports and exports are due to the exchange rate changes, it's also called the trade approach or otherwise the elasticity approach. The model is based upon certain simplifying assumption. It assumes that the supply elasticity for domestic export good as well as foreign import good are perfectly elastic. Changes in the demand obviously will have no influence on the price. Domestic and foreign prices are assumed to be fixed. These assumptions ensure that the only changes in relative prices will be caused by the changes in the nominal exchange rate. The other assumptions are there is a balanced trade and country's current account balance equals its trade balance. Now let us derive the important Marshall-Lerner condition, which is a part of the elasticity approach. By setting the domestic as well as foreign price level into unity, we will define the current account as CA is equal to X minus RM, where CA is the current account, X is the export, R is the exchange rate, M is the import. Now, using the difference form to find out the changes in current account, we have DCA equals DX minus R into DM minus M into DR. Now, dividing this equation with the changes in the exchange rate DR, our equation will become DCA by DR equals DX by DR minus R into DM by DR minus M. Now, at this point, we will introduce two definitions of elasticity, namely the price elasticity of demand for export as well as price elasticity of for demand for our import as well. Now, starting with the export, the price elasticity of demand for export eta x is defined as dx by x divided by dr by r. That is, the percentage change in quantity exported divided by the percentage change in the nominal exchange rate. On the other hand, the price elasticity of demand for imports eta m is defined as minus of dm by m divided by dr by r. That is the percentage change in quantity imported divided by the percentage change in the exchange rate. We are only dealing with the changes in the exchange rate because as per assumption, the prices are assumed to be fixed. There is no changes in the prices. So the only changes that we are considering is the changes in the exchange rate. That's why this model only looks at what happens to the current account when there is a change in exchange rate in the form of devaluation. Now, setting the equation, elasticity equations for dx and dm and replacing their term in the above equation, we will have this equation dca by dr equals m into eta x plus eta m minus 1. This equation is known as the celebrated Marshall-Lerner condition. It says that devaluation will improve the current account. That is, DCA by DR will be greater than zero if and only if the sum of foreign elasticity of demand for exports and home elasticity of demand for imports is greater than unity. That is, eta x plus eta m is greater than 1. Only when the sum of the two elasticities are greater than 1, DCA by DR will be positive. That is, devaluation will lead to an improvement in the current account. If the sum of these two elasticities is less than unity, then devaluation will lead to a deterioration in the current account. Now, according to the elasticity approach, there are two effects when a currency is devalued, which are the price effect as well as volume effect. Price effect is the immediate effect of devaluation. When a devaluation took place, our exports become cheaper and our imports become costlier. If volume is not responding, it will lead to a worsening of the balance of trade. On the other hand, since the export have become cheaper, the volume of export will rise. Since the import have become costlier, the volume of import will fall. It will lead to an improvement in the balance of trade as well. So, the net effects depends upon which price effect, either price effect or volume effect is dominating. If volume effect is dominating over the price effect, then obviously devaluation can lead to an improvement in the current account. Now, we are shifting our focus to the empirical evidence. The novelty of elasticity approach is that it brings out the possibility that devaluation can lead to the worsening of current account rather than an improvement. It leads to a number of research into the empirical estimates of elasticity of export and import. We can classify the economists into two groups. There are the elasticity optimists who believe that the sum of these two elasticities tend to exceed unity. It is greater than one. That is, when a country undertakes devaluation, it will lead to an improvement in the current account. On the other hand, elasticity pessimists believe that the sum of the two elasticities tends to be less than unity. That is, devaluation will lead to the worsening of current account. But the general consensus among the empirical studies is that devaluation may work better for industrialized countries rather than developing countries. Because for the industrialized countries, the elasticity coefficient will be high and devaluation can lead to an improvement in the current account. But developing countries, since their elasticity coefficient will be small, should use the method of devaluation to correct their balance of payment crisis with a lot of amount of caution. Now, we are shifting our focus to a related concept, namely the J curve. Basically, J curve is a follow up of our Marshall-Lehner condition. It says that in short run, the devaluation can lead to the worsening of balance of trade. That is, the elasticity coefficient will be smaller and lower in the short run. That is, there is greater possibility that Marshall-Lehner condition may not be holding in the short run, but it will hold only in the long run. Devaluation can lead to a short run worsening of current account before ultimately it gets better. Now, let us look into the J curve. In our example, this country, which is facing a current account deficit, at point T1 resorts to devaluation. So that initially there is a lagged response, in the sense that the price effect will dominate, the elasticity coefficient will be small, so it lead to a deterioration of the current account. But ultimately, as time goes on, in long run, it improves. So, the pattern will resemble the English alphabet J. That is why this curve is known as the J curve. So, the J curve says that even though as a result of devaluation, the current account deficit become much worse, ultimately it can improve. So, there is a lag response to the current account balance to devaluation. In short run, the export volume and import volume do not change much, so that the volume effect will not respond and the price effect will be more than the volume effect. But after a time lag, the export volume, the volumes tend to respond. Consequently, the current account deficit starts to decline or to improve, and eventually the country can move towards the surplus. So initially there will be a deterioration, but ultimately it will lead to an improvement. Now, the problem with the Marshall-Lehner condition is that there is a lagged response. Now, not only that there are usually lags in response, but also the increase in the domestic prices of imported commodity may be sometimes smaller than the amount of depreciation or devaluation even after lags. That possibility was explained by what is known as the currency pass-through. That is, if a country's tend to solve their or try to solve its balance of payment crisis by undertaking a devaluation. Let us say, for example, 10% devaluation. We expect that the prices of import commodities now will rise by 10%, but this might not happen. That means the increase in the prices of imported commodities will be less than 10%. That possibility is explained by the currency pass-through. Now, what is currency pass-through? It is the percentage by which import prices rises when a country's currency depreciates or devaluates by 1% is known as the degree of pass-through from the exchange rate to import prices. And currency pass-through says that these pass-through will be incomplete. So, pass-through from depreciation to the domestic prices may be less than complete. And there are two reasons. One, the foreign firm, who are the exporters, will be reluctant to increase their prices by the full amount of depreciation, because they feel that they will lose the market or hard-earned market. So they might be willing to absorb a part of the burden rather than increasing the prices in an immediate way after depreciation or devaluation. The second reason is that the international market segmentation that allows an imperfectly competitive firm to charge different prices for the same product in different countries. That is, in one country it may be facing an issue of depreciation and may be forced to increase the prices, but in the other country it may be facing an issue of appreciation as well. So there is an international market segmentation that allows the firm to charge different prices in different countries. That's the second reason. Now, foreign firms which are willing to wait, they want to see whether this process is a momentum or acquire a momentum is a real before they increase the prices. In short run, this pass-through will be incomplete. So the degree of pass-through will be less than one in the short run, but in long run, when the permanent long run exchange rate changes, sometimes may fully reflect the import prices. That means taking our example, that 10% increase in the import prices may happen in the long run. But foreign firms will be, at least in the short run period, they will be willing to wait whether this currency movement reflects a definite and a clear cut trend before making a changes in the prices. One of the major defects of the elasticity approach is that it is based on the assumption of other things being equal, the ceteris paribus. It only focuses on the elasticity of export and import as well as their volume. But the changes in the volume of export and import will influence the national income. So an income effect of devaluation must be incorporated for a more comprehensive analysis. In fact, this is the theme of the absorption approach. The elasticity approach was developed by Sidney Alexander in his work, The Effect of Devaluation on Trade Balance, published in the year 1952. The approach, in part, is a reaction against the restrictive assumption underlying the elasticity approach, and it emphasizes the income effect of devaluation. Thus, the approach is more comprehensive in nature when we compare it with the elasticity approach. It's also known as the Keynesian approach because it's based on the Keynesian national income relationship. Now, let us derive the model. We will start from an open economy national income equation where Y is equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. where Y is the national income or output, C is the consumption expenditure, G is the autonomous government expenditure, X is export, M is import. Now, slightly rearranging this equation, we will get it as X minus M is equal to Y minus within bracket C plus I plus G. Or X minus M is nothing but the current account. So, current account can be viewed as CA is equal to Y minus C plus I plus G. C means consumption expenditure, I is investment expenditure, G is autonomous government expenditure. It is nothing but the aggregate domestic expenditure. Now, we will define absorption as C plus I plus G. Now, defining the domestic absorption as A, which is equal to C plus I plus G, the current account can be expressed as CA is equal to Y minus A. This is a basic relationship in the absorption approach, which says that current account represents the difference between the domestic income or output and the domestic absorption. Current account surplus means that domestic output or income exceeds domestic spending, while current account deficit means that domestic output is less than domestic expenditure or spending. And the current account balance will be improved only if we can increase the output related to that of absorption as well. Now, using the difference form, we can explain it as DCA, change in current account, is equal to change in income minus change in absorption. So, the effect of devaluation on current account depends upon how it affects income and how it affects the absorption. So, if the devaluation can raise the domestic income than that of domestic absorption, then current account can improve. If the opposite is true, it can worsen the current account deficit as well. Now, we will first focus on the absorption, then move on to the effect of devaluation on national income. Now, absorption can be divided into two parts. A rise in income will lead to an increase in absorption, which is determined by the marginal propensity to absorb. And the second aspect is that there is some part of absorption which is unrelated to income. That is, it is directly affected by devaluation rather than through the changes in income. We call it as a direct absorption. So, changes in absorption, dA is equal to A into dy. A is the marginal propensity to absorb, D is the changes in y, changes in income. dA is equal to A into dy plus dD, that is changes in the direct absorption. So, incorporating this relationship into our equation, we have changes in current account is equal to dy minus dA. We have already found out what is dA. dA is equal to a dy plus dD. Now, substituting the value of dA into our current account equation, our equation will become dCA is equal to dy minus a into dy minus dD. You can see that dy is common in the equation, so we can take it out from the equation as a common factor, and our final equation will become something like this. dCA is equal to 1 minus a into dy minus dD. Now, the absorption approach says that the condition for devaluation to improve the current account is that 1 minus a into dy must be greater than dD. That is, any change in income not spent on absorption, that is 1 minus a into dy, must exceed any change in the direct absorption, which is dd. 1 minus a into dy must be greater than dd so that the devaluation will lead to an improvement in the current account. Now, there are two ways through which the devaluation can affect the level of national income. First way is that it increases the production of exports as well as import competitive goods. If there are unemployed resources in the economy, then devaluation will lead to an increase in national income and it will lead to an improvement in the current account. But if the country is already having a situation of full employment, national income cannot increase and it will only lead to an increase in the price level. The second impact of devaluation, effect of devaluation on national income is that it leads to a deterioration in the terms of trade. It is because of the fact that when a country undertakes devaluation, its exports become cheaper, its imports become expensive. That is, if the quantity is not responding, it will lead to a deterioration in the terms of trade. That is, our devaluation makes our import costlier as well as export cheaper, leads to a deterioration in the terms of trade. So, overall, the effect of devaluation on national income is not very clear. It depends upon which factor is the dominant one.
Thus, we have seen two divergent approaches towards balance of payment and devaluation. There's a third approach called monetary approach, which will be the theme of another session. You can always visit our blog www.skpeco.blogspot.in. Hope that this video is useful to you. Until next time, stay safe, happy learning. Thank you.